Everybody, it's Evicta. It's time to continue the Eden streak here in the Binding of Isaac Victa Afterbirth Plus series. Well, it happened. Rip like streak. Unfortunately, like streak did not get to the next goal of 14. Unfortunately, at the time of this recording, the minimal damage, I think the name is that was the title of that episode, only got just barely under 1,500. So there's no doubt about it. We got to start again. But hey, that's okay. As you saw right there, I did change up the 21-day streak reward with the Revelations mod or whatever it was called. Somebody's been excitedly suggesting that I play that one schmod. I don't know why I'm talking like that. Also, here's your meme of the day. This one was sent in by it's also off of, a little bit off center. Let me fix that real quick here. There we go. Yeah, so y'all got any more of them speed upgrades? Thank you very much to Vagrant22 for the person who is responsible for uploading that one. That one was day before yesterday at the time of this recording. So yeah, thank you all very much. Go check out the memes on the subreddit /r/Sinvicta. Let's start again. No more sad trombone. Okay. Seed day is going to be Charlie Delta Foxtrot Bravo Golf Alpha Victor Lima. We've got Libra, so our stats are going to be all over the place. We also have what I believe is Jar of Flies and Rosary, which immediately saves us from death. With this being Curse the Blind, of course, we have absolutely no idea what we're going to be seeing on this floor. But a Libra start is always interesting because we have some options of taking items that we normally would not be taking. Like, say, for example, like a huge speed upgrade. Normally, I shy away from those just because I'm not a huge fan of a lot of movement speed. But with the fact that we have Libra, that means it's going to balance all of our stats out based on, well, just balancing them all out. Secret room might be here, although I've never seen it attached to this room before. Until now. There we go. Now, if you're wondering where we got all the keys and the bombs from, whenever you get Libra, you actually are given a bunch of consumables. Because it balances out literally everything, including your money as well. So, yeah, and that, as you see up there, this is indeed Jar of Flies. Of course, we don't see anything, and I don't like to buy stuff that I can't readily see, and yeah, we're just gonna go ahead and get rid of that right now. Do not want a Suicide King anywhere near my freaking Renegade left ring finger, which is my favorite Weird Al Yankovic song. I'm actually gonna be super lazy here because we don't have. I mean, yeah, we could get some flies, but like, I'd rather just like not go stay in that room. Look, if we've got the bombs, I'm gonna use them. Okay. Have a Tenon Rock here as well. Now, there's a very neat little trick that you can do in here, and I'll show you after we're done clearing this room. And by that, I mean letting it clear itself. But what you can do is if you want to absolutely guarantee that you get into the dead center, where you can hit both sides of this hallway, but you're like, oh, I don't know, I'm going to see if, let me try to eyeball it here. The best thing to do is walk out, walk back in. Don't go up or down. Just stay straight on the horizontal plane. That's all you have to do. It gets both of them there. And should also get both of them here. I don't care about the red hearts, of course. I'm just going over here because this bomb costs us nothing. And with a flat penny, that's going to give us an extra key. Now, we could take the matchstick, but I would rather have more keys just for the golden chest. Because we all know that eventually we're going to find a Tenant Rock that is going to give us a golden chest, which is all comical and all that kind of good stuff. I'm going to hold on to the last two bombs here, even though I am kind of tempted to use it against Gemini because it does destroy Gemini pretty quickly. I'm not going to be that lazy with them. So what do you do with a Libra start? Well, you get excited first off because, again, you can imagine the potential stat ups that you're going to be getting. If you're into taking pills, which of course I'm not, but if you are into taking pills, pills become a lot more attractive in terms of getting stat ups because obviously if you get like, say, a movement speed up or if you get a tears up or anything like that, or range up, it's going to give you an all stats up pill. So, technically speaking, it's not an all stat up pill, but it is going to be an all stat up pill because you're going to be increasing your stats. Curse of Loss, no big deal. Of course, we have an excellent amount of HP thanks to the combination of the Rosary as well as PJs, which don't actually give you stats, but it does give you a lot of soul hearts. You do have to be kind of careful when you come into this room here, because if you try to cut over too quickly, you're going to get swarmed by the other flies coming from the bottom of the screen. So do what I did, which was like kind of like a fake out, and then do like a double backflip, turn around, cartwheel and motorcycle and roller coaster or something like that. Now I'm going to do something in here which you shouldn't really ever do, which is to let your jar of flies actually cap out. The reason why I'm going to do that here is just because we don't really need the flies to help us out take down these flies. And I don't want them to be wasted on just regular flies. Like, if we're going to have 20 flies, I want them to be going into something more dangerous or something more annoying, like these flies, for example. So we're going to let the flies get all over them. There we go. Now, don't get discouraged about the light streak now. I know that might be a little demoralizing for some people. And I'm not ready to drop it yet. I'm not ready to drop the light streak yet. Or not the light streak, but drop it down to, like, say, 1,700 or 1,500. I actually think that would be a little bit more detrimental to than just simply starting the streak over again. And the reason why is because I am convinced. I am convinced, and I'm going to be unshakable from this conviction here. I'm convinced that we will get back to where we were. I mean, we were almost at 14 with a 2,000 like streak in the past like week and a half. So like it's entirely possible. Now, what fluctuates the difference between the people who like the videos and people who don't watch or simply just don't care? I'm not exactly sure. I thought that the minimal damage run was kind of interesting because of the fact we didn't have any damage and we still ended up going to Mega Satan. So in that regards, I may have failed in the quote unquote marketing of that episode. I should have come up with a little bit of a better thumbnail, something like that. But other than that, like the other episodes from this past week have been amazing. We've been having a huge boost, especially the Isaac Gatling gun episode. That one went bonkers. So thank you all very much. And I do realize and recognize that a lot of the favor in terms of like how many people see an episode or how visible it is curried a lot by the quality of the thumbnail, which I have. I'm currently in the process of getting updated thumbnails from a different artist and looking to change up the look of it, because I've had the same thumbnails now for about a couple years, almost 2 years, I would say. Also getting really hot in my room for some reason. I'm not sure why. But unseasonably mild these past couple of days. I talked about it yesterday. It only got up to like 81 or 82 today in Texas, or at least in Houston. And it was feeling pretty good outside. I was surprised. The sky was blue. I had to spend most of the day in the studio today, but the times when I was able to go out and like get some food, and we were just, you know, going out. Everyone wants to go for a smoke break, that sort of thing. It was beautiful outside today. So in other words, the room being hot is not related to the weather. I mean, it's hot outside, but it's been cooler. Bad. I took a bad angle there. I should have gone at a much sharper angle to the left here. So we get Speedball, which is going to be huge stat ups here, because again, keep in mind we have Libra. That's going to give us all stats up. We get the Bible inside of the Devil deal, and that's because of our good old friend Rosary. So I am going to take the Bible now. I'm not going to hold on to it, however. I still think Jar of Flies is far and away a better item, but I'm just doing that for the deal with the Devil Precedent, and we'll head on down to the next Flizzor here in the Binding of I don't know. I closed Discord there. Someone was trying to send me a file, which I am not able to see right now. So yeah, I'm always looking forward whenever we take a step back. It's like, okay, we get to, this is a golden opportunity to restart the league, restart the league as well as the streak, and B, get to evaluate and say, okay, well, let's see what worked from this last streak up until the point where it broke. And then just, you know, how can we improve things? You know, and that's the interesting and fun challenge that is this job. Whenever you do something, it works. I mean, there was a great post on Twitter the other day by a guy named Dan's Gaming, who I'm sure most of you if you watch Twitch, you know at least who Dan is. Maybe you don't watch him that much. I personally don't watch Dan that often, but I do follow him on Twitter because he's an interesting guy, and his name is Dan's Gaming on Twitter, and on Twitch as well. But anyway, he posted an interesting thing talking about, you know, it's always a little bit demoralizing whenever as a streamer or as a media producer, whatever you want to call us. Whenever you try a new game and like you instantly see the viewer count go way down. Like if I'm playing Isaac, like Isaac can draw up to 200-300 people whenever I'm playing, and then I'll switch to something else, like I'll switch to like Epic 7 or something like that, and it would go down to like 80, you know. And what Dan was talking about, Dan was saying, you know, it is a little bit frightening and unnerving, and also adds a lot of pressure to the streamer, to the YouTuber, you know, influencer, whatever the hell you want to call us. And it's like, you know, it's almost as if like you're doing something wrong, you know. And the same thing kind of applies when it comes to videos. You know, it's if I do non-Isaac related stuff, there's a clear difference in the numbers. I mean, I'm not naive or ignoring that fact. You know, people are going to follow you what they want to follow you for. Some people that follow me don't watch Isaac at all. And they come out to watch, you know, Lobotomy Corporation, Risk of Rain 2, or any of the other stuff, or even the GeoGuessr collabs and stuff. But I don't get down from it. It doesn't really bother me as much as you may think it does. You know, it's never fun to watch numbers go down or to watch a like streak break, but it doesn't bum me out because like, okay, well, let's reevaluate stuff and let's see what we can do to improve on so it doesn't happen again, or if it does happen again, at least it won't be for the same reason. And Co Carnage is who's another guy who I do actually watch occasionally on Twitch, but he's a very prolific streamer on Twitch. He chimed in and said he sort of feels the same way. You know, it is a little bit disturbing. I guess when you're at that level, I don't understand it up to a certain point because I don't bring in the numbers that those guys do, but at that number, when you're talking with, for me, you're talking about the difference of like 100 to 200 people. For them, you're talking difference of thousands of people. So I can definitely understand the magnitude of watching all those numbers go away so quickly just from the simple act of just wanting to play something else. I can sort of understand to a point of how that must feel, you know. But even when, in terms of Isaac, when we were really firing on all cylinders about a month and a half ago, before the crash happened, the Isaac episodes we were banking about, it was about 20 to 25,000 views on average per episode, regardless of what was going on in the thumbnail and everything else. And like Lobotomy Corporation or Risk of Rain, they were only doing like, you know, maybe 2,000, 3,000 views. Risk of Rain performed a lot better. And I will readily admit that not putting out as much Risk of Rain 2 content definitely contributed to the downward trend of us getting, like, you know, recommended by the algorithm, blah, blah, blah. Because Risk of Rain 2 was a huge factor in my channel taking off earlier in this year, a couple months ago, as it did. And whenever I stopped doing that, you know, the recommendations started going down, the engagement started going down because I just wasn't putting out the content that people want to see. People wanted to see more Risk of Rain 2 stuff. But again, I have never been that guy to force myself to play something that I just do not like to play or I just don't feel like playing. And Risk of Rain 2, while it's a great game, and I still actually do play it, which we will be having more content coming up for that game probably next week. GeoGuessr sort of like cut into that. But Risk of Rain 2, it got to a point for me and before the Rex patch hit where it was just like every run was pretty much the same. Like there's only so much that you can do, at least for me in that game, to a point where it's just chaos on the screen and you're just trying to survive, you know. And the problem, it's twofold, because for me, for my commentary, my presentation style, I like to do, you know, interactive commentary. I mean, it's not exactly play by play, but it's also not like sitting back and podcasting. Like, you know, for Isaac, we can be strategic sometimes when we have to be. But for Risk of Rain 2, it always just devolved into absolute madness on the screen, and there's not a whole lot you can really do as a presenter after a certain point strategy-wise in that game. So that was starting to eat at me a little bit. That and the runs kept getting exceedingly longer and longer. And honestly, that's where Lobotomy Corporation is about to be reaching soon. And it's not because I don't want to work longer hours. This will never feel like work to me. But yeah, there's a lot of things you have to consider, especially when you're talking about, like, you know, my voice and that sort of stuff. And overdoing it, because you know, as the years wear on, you know, my voice is not staying as strong as it used to be. Especially after the tonsillitis. That was awful. Like, looking back on how much pain I went through for that tonsillitis stuff, man, it was just terror. It was awful. And I mean, I don't really know how else to personify the situation like that. You know, it was just awful. And every now and then my throat would get a little bit sore. And I'm like, you know, are we starting to have to worry about a flare-up or something like that again? But luckily, it goes away. I've been taking way better care of my voice, especially. We're still working on Song 12 right now, as I was talking about yesterday. Today, we actually had a shorter session, but we're working on the drums and that sort of thing. Luckily, I didn't have to do vocals today. But with us being more active in the studio now, I do have to be conscious of that, because the voice has to sound good. For all of our songs and that sort of stuff. So there's a lot of things to consider when you're talking about it. It's not just me not wanting to spend a lot of time playing one game. There's a lot of other factors into that other than that. Because, I mean, it is true. While I don't really necessarily want to do 2 hours per episode of Isaac because I like the game, same thing goes for Lobotomy Corporation, it just doesn't make a whole lot of sense to do so in the grand scheme of things. I'm going to take Remote Detonator here just because I want those 5 bombs. Ooh, well, compost doesn't really make a whole lot of sense right now. We don't have any way of passively creating flies. What I'm really looking for here is either Black Candle or Champion Belt. I don't know how Mom's Trinket Box works with the Counterfeit Penny. We get Hive Mind, but we also get Mama Mega. We have to go Hive Mind here. Hive Mind gives us Beelzebub. Thanks to us getting the, it's this combination of Jar of Flies, Hive Mind, and the Lost Fly. If we can somehow get Mama Mega, no, we wouldn't really take Mama Mega anyway, because, I mean, I'm just going to, I would just use it just to get in and get out of Boss Rush. So we get the Caffeine Pill, which is going to give us an all stats up, and we get Guppy's Paw along with Death's Freaking Touch. Let's actually go. We're going to take Death's Touch. We're going to take Guppy's Paw here. Death's Touch, even though it gives us a Tears Down, the huge damage up it gives you overall with Libra gives you a big all stats up. Yeah, that's fine. Got like a dead Eddie. That one I'm not gonna finish. I was gonna say we have a dead but someone who's very alive person look going for right now, and I probably shouldn't be saying that. I'm just gonna that was a bad joke, bad bit. Anyway, obviously with this run we have not great damage, but our stats will only go up from here unless if I get Curse the Blind and I take like Ease Mascara or something like that. And that's where the value of Libra shines, you know. But I'm playing fast and loose right now just because there's, with Death's Touch, that gives us a huge advantage over where we normally would be here. But that's just based solely on the strength of the tier effect, combined with the fact that we have Hive Mind and Jar of Freaking Flies. We're getting lucky here with these Soul Heart drops. We definitely got lucky early on with the Rosary as well. But we don't, this is not a game ender one run set of stats yet. We're getting there though. If we can maintain the amount of flies that we've got, as well as like you know, slowly but steadily increasing our damage, then, yeah, we're going to start balling out of control. Of course, Guppy would be huge. If we end up getting Guppy on top of us having Hive Mind, we would also have that in conjunction with having Jar of Flies. I mean, that's going to be that is so much damage we're talking about. Then we're talking about balling out of control, sick, nasty, crazy style. And now that we've confirmed that there's nothing on the northern portion of this fine level right here, couldn't say that with a straight face. We're going to head on down and find the actual direction we're supposed to go. In a weird way, I get excited whenever we have to start over. Not in like a I'm overcompensating with positivity because it's so negative sort of way. Like there's, I don't remember her name, but there's a YouTuber, and don't ask me why this was in my recommendations. I just don't know. But there's a YouTuber who apparently launched a makeup line or something, and it had like metal shards and all this stuff. She's some makeup YouTuber. And I've watched two videos now of this woman, like, basically checking all the boxes, all the fake YouTuber personality boxes that I've got, you know, like overly apologetic, talking about saying, oh, I love this community, calling everyone fam and friends and stuff, you know, that whole tropes of stuff. And you know, and I'm not like that. I try to be as open and honest with people when it comes to, I guess that technically is one of them. Oh my goodness. Well, Quad Shot is exclusively an all stats down with Libra, but it's an all stats down we're willing to take, just because of how crazy it can also ball out of control, especially if we end up getting Guppy, which we have a decent shot of. We still have to get the Devil Deal here, but let's find out if we are going to or going to not do. Also going to find the Super Seeker Room. It's going to be right here. The candles here pointing upwards kind of gave that away. I should have known them. Calling everyone fam, like family and that sort of thing. It's like, I can't do it, man. I can't do it. I appreciate everyone who watches me. I appreciate everyone who calls themselves a fan of mine. But I won't go beyond that. You know, you hear a lot of people say, I say fam ironically because I like making fun of Mathis. Which, by the way, for some reason, there's been a general uptick in the amount of concerned posts. There's been a general uptick in the amount of concerned people who seem to think that I have something against Mathis, because I was picking on him quite hard in one episode of Lobotomy Corporation, and that was alarming people for some odd reason. But no, Mathis is a good friend of mine. I've known him for years. I wouldn't know anyone in the NLSS. I wouldn't be in the NLSS crew if it weren't for Mathis. I would have never been able to do that video with Ryan. You know, so I owe Mathis a lot. So he's a good buddy of mine. Just friendly ribbing, nothing more than that. But you know, but calling everyone like there's a channel I no longer watch, which I'm not afraid to say which channel it is. There's a channel that's it was very interesting to me, and I'm sure some of you at least are familiar with it. It was called Ants Canada. It's the saga of an ant keeper. It's a guy who takes care of ants. And he puts on a very interesting way of presenting like his content. You know, he had viewers like vote on the names of the types of species of ants that he has. Like one's like the Golden Empire. The other one's like his fire ants and that sort of stuff. And it was very interesting. I unsubscribed from him though, because he was getting a little bit too clickbaity, and he would constantly he got into a really bad habit of leaving stuff on cliffhangers. So the biggest one was he was like, you know, there, he was going to reveal this big reveal, and it was in the thumbnail and everything. So that guy, I mean, it was the absolute quintessential poster child of clickbait. And then at the very end of the video, right before he was about to reveal what this creature was, he ended up cutting to black and saying, see you next week, which that pissed a whole lot of people off, including myself. I was like, all right, well, because he's kind of done stuff like that in the past. And I was like, you know, I can tolerate it, but but it almost gets insulting to a point, which is the reason why I'm so careful with the thumbnails, by the way. But anyway, you know, the like Ants Canada has, he calls his channel, his community, there's that word again, the AC fam. And I'm like, I cringe every time I hear it, man, because I'm like, man, there's just something about calling people who aren't, who you don't know, family, that is unsettling to me, you know. And I'll never, the mosh pit's the mosh pit, don't get me wrong, but we're not family. You know, I pull no punches about that. I take the same stance, somewhat the same stance that John had, that TV has, in terms of fans versus, you know, more than just fans, that sort of thing. That disconnect to me is important, because there someone brought up, I don't remember the name of this YouTuber, and I apologize for that. It was a response to one. It was just, it's like one of those drama channels that just like refutes like apology videos and whatnot. I don't remember the name of the channel, but this YouTuber made an excellent point about, you have to be careful. You have to be careful with YouTubers and influencers. They influence more than products, was the general point. And you have to be careful, or at least you should take a responsible measure if you are the YouTuber. You got to be wary of people who call you fam and family, because they do want to make you feel included. You know, everyone of course wants to be a part of something bigger. They want to be included. They want to feel like they belong somewhere. But you got to be very careful with some people out there are very good manipulators, and it's very easy to get sucked into, you know, whoa, I'm part of this YouTuber's family. They call me fam. We're friends, you know. That's when problems start rising. That's when you start getting people showing up to, you know, like public places or even private places, being like, you know, hey, I thought we were friends, sort of thing. It's like, you know, that's a can of worms I'm not going to get into, because I'm not smart enough nor well versed enough to enter arguments into that situation. All I'm trying to say, all this was just to prove how much I mean when I say that I do get excited, and then I went off on a tangent. But I do get excited whenever there's the like streak ends up dropping, because it's like, okay, well, we get to analyze what gets wrong, and we get to what went wrong, and we get to fix it. Just another chance, you know. Thank you for the opportunity. But then I went into one of my usual tangents, because this run that we're on is very good. Damage-wise, it's not the best. Or Babylon and the Sin Robes certainly are going to be good. It gives us an all stats up. I would love to get a little bit more movement speed. But as you can see here, the decision to take quad shot was a non-issue. I mean, you just take quad shot. Even though, again, it's extensively an all stats down, you still take it, especially if you have piercing shot, especially if you have death's touch. You know, now, are we going to get Guppy? Well, that's still up to the game, but I would hope so. There was a Tender Rock here. That's actually where the Soul Heart came from, not from the bomb chest, or the stone chest. We have Skolex, so I'm going to keep our flies right where they belong, because Skolex is going to waste them. Plus, again, we have piercing shots, plus tech zero, plus, not zero, but tech 0.5. That should be pretty clear now that we're in a one-run status. I mean, it was iffy at the start, but as soon as we got the rosary, that's when everything kind of, whoa, my, what is going on? Skolex has three different parts. I'm terrified. Someone screenshot that and put it on Reddit or tweeted at me. For a second there, Skolex was in two different places at the same time. We cut it in half, and that was very weird. Also, that's weird that this door was sealed when we came in here, and then it opened immediately. If you don't believe me, go back, rewind it, just hit the back button real quick. Not the back button, but hit the left arrow on your keyboard. If you are watching this from a keyboard, mobile devices, double tap the left side. Anyway, you'll hear the sound effect, actually, that door opening about a half second after we entered that room, which is kind of odd because there's nothing in there to fight. I'm going to check inside the boss trap room, because it is possible that there might be a guppy item in here. until now. We're rock and rolling. I always like the conversation of I've already railed about the word community. I'm not going to do it again. But conversations in general talking about like the separation of fans versus, you know, actual friends and stuff is a topic that's it's a little uncomfortable because some people can misconstrue that in a way that in a way that's like, you know, makes you feel less important. You know, it's like, well, if we're not friends, then, you know, where are we? Are we enemies? Or, you know, what am I? It's like, oh, you're a supporter. You know, and you're a fan. You know, I am a fan of, this is a better way to probably quantify the situation. I am a fan of Metallica. Everyone knows that. I'm a fan of James Hetfield, who I've met before. You know, do I expect me to be able to call James, being like, hey, James, what's going on, buddy? No, of course not. Do I expect to show up somewhere and just be welcomed into his home? No. You know, now I'm not trying to equate myself to James Hetfield of Metallica. Invicta is not James Hetfield of Metallica. I'm nobody. But that's the sort of that's the type of expectations that I try to harbor with you guys and gals out there. Okay, rude disappointed. Yep. Do we take the sun card or do we stick with the black rune? The black rune, I'm going to be honest, the black rune, even though it gives us stats, because we have Libra, it's a little bit of a slippery slope there. The black rune can give you a lot of stats. I don't want to do this. It can give us a lot of stats here. I don't really. It's a hard choice. I guess we'll take the black rune. We'll go fight Hush because I want to see. I want to see what we can black rune in there. The point I was making with that is that the black rune, it can give you very little stats, but with Libra it sometimes can give you big stats. It really just depends on what the black rune ends up giving you. In other words, little baggy we're not gonna be taking. Oh my goodness. Well, that's going to be a big stat up for everything. Yeah, so we can probably... That is wait what, but we can probably X-nay this one here. Yeah, so that... It gave us a pretty significant stats up there. Oh my goodness, and we have restock, and there's a half-price item. Let's go. First off, if we can get a two of diamonds, that'd be great. I need two of diamonds.
Ace of hearts.
I'm gonna buy one more. Okay. I need a box. Pay to play. More options is pretty useless. I will take stopwatch. Starter deck. Ooh. What is this? Joker card. I'm not gonna use that here. Ooh. Buddy, you got yourself a... Got yourself a keeper here. And we get the jumper cables. Now, jumper cables plus compost. And actually, you know what? Let's back this up here. Victor, what are you doing? Well, because we know that the blue hourglass is here, I want to try to get... I want to see if there's a two of diamonds in this stack. So we need to get to where we have restock real quick. Or the items are completely different for some reason. Wait a second. Trinket smelter and... I'm very confused. The smelter and the blue candle weren't... They weren't first in that last time, were they? And I just didn't notice it? I'm pretty sure that smelter wasn't there. Well, anyway, what I was going to do is I was going to take the blue candle and then I was going to search for the two of diamonds, but it doesn't matter now. Look, whenever I get to this point, like, I always just want to break the game. Okay, so we got compost. I am going to use compost here. Use it out here, actually, because there's a lot of stuff we can compost in here. And we can take this. and do a little bit of this. Then we will take this, and we'll go into the hush fight. Old Hushy. Paying a visit to our friend, Old Hushy. Hush is not friends with anyone. Definitely not us. What is this baby doing? We got like, we have like wire coat hanger Tiny Planet baby. Use compost here just to double our flies and spiders. Now remember, we have jumper cables, so it is entirely possible we'll get another charge here. Assuming Hush spawns a lot of ads, which he always does. But we've lost all of our flies, almost anyway, so doesn't really matter that much. I am going to hold on to the Joker card. Hopefully we can get a good, hopefully we can get Guppy, that would be nice. Inside of Le Cathedral. And if you're wondering where these where those health bars came from, we got it from Spider Mod from the shop. That's where the same damage numbers and the health bars on Hush came from as well. There we go. Completely forgot that I forgot that we picked up school bag. We could have had 40 flies by now, Sinvicta. Bad spot. Here we go. Okay. All right. You got me, Hush. Congrats. Now you just made everything a whole lot harder on yourself. Hope you're happy. You're seeing here the power of Jar of Flies because of the fact that we get a fly for every one of the flies that we kill from Hush. And on top of that, you have this wombo combo of compost plus Jar of Flies, which is going to give us double the amount of flies after we use compost. That is pretty gnarly. I mean, look how many flies we have. Now, I have confirmed that there is a limit for the amount of flies that compost will grant you, but there's not a limit for the ones that you can spawn with Jar of Flies, as you're seeing right now. We've got probably 100 flies right now. Let's go ahead and see what this does to Hush. It instantly put him into the next phase. So that's good. And it just did it again. I mean, our damage isn't all that incredible. It's only 7.66, but when we crash, like, you know, 70, 80,000 flies, okay, well, maybe not that many, but like 60 or 70 flies in the Hush, you're gonna feel it. His super armor be damned. And you also have to remember that we've got Hive Mind as well, so our flies are hitting for even more damage. Man, that, like, watching this girl apologize for her crappy makeup and stuff it's like watching a train wreck. It's the fascination of, like, you know, let's go look at the bodies. By the way, I'm not being morbid on purpose. That's actually a George Carlin skit. Before you get mad at me for saying let's go look at the bodies, he was talking about was the train wreck syndrome, where if you just see a train wreck, like, you know, you can't help but be fascinated. You know, it's like seeing a really bad car accident. You see a lot of people doing what's called rubbernecking, or they're all a bunch of looky-loos, as also called. What in the world, baby, is that? He's shooting it. It's shooting a continuum death's touch with, like, no range. Interesting. And as luck would have it, we get Krampus after using our Joker card, so that's okay. I mean, there's nothing really to complain about on this run. I'm just saying, you know. I'm just saying. What's this? Volcano. Isn't that ironic? Don't you think? It's like rain! No. That song got played out so quickly. The first time I heard "Ironic" by Alanis Morissette, I was like, you know what? I can hear myself listening to this. I can hear myself hearing this. But after it got played like a million times on MTV, it's like, okay, this song is just getting old. It's not fun anymore, you know. Oh wow, we actually went straight to Isaac. Gonna back out because I don't want to consume this battery. Yeah. That is absolute domination. We get it at the very end. We also have like the Lich King Abaddon baby or something going on here. At the end of the day, I want to say thank you everybody for the support in the non-cliche YouTuber way. In the non-manipulative sense, thank you all very much. And I can promise you, 100% promise you, from now until the end of time, that I will never release a makeup line that will do anything. I'm never gonna release my own makeup. Although I will say that seeing how popular some of that stuff is from Sephora, yes, I've been in Sephora many times. Not for me, of course, but for, you know, you got a girlfriend, you gotta buy Sephora stuff. It's that simple. In the past, not right now, but in the past. Anyway. This is one of those things where, like, the more you talk, the more it's going to be, like, looking worse and worse. And actually, that is ironic, because that is how all these YouTuber apology videos end up coming out. You know, and a lot... What's so great about seeing the comments in those videos are you realize how dumb the YouTuber thinks most of the watchers are, and then you read the YouTuber comments, and that makes you realize how smart... actually a lot of the viewers are. A lot of the time the biggest criticism in the one video I'm talking about is, like, you know, how can someone speak for upwards of 20 minutes and not say anything? Which is true. I mean, that's what happens in Westworld. That's the reason why I don't watch that show anymore. Ayo. See, it's all coming back to pop culture, man. Don't worry, your boy's got it on lockdown, even though I can't name any popular pop stars other than Cardi B, which I was called out on because everyone's like, she's a rapper, she's not a pop star. I'm pretty sure rappers can be pop stars. What's going on here? Whoa, that's a lot of pins. Yep, making sure I'm using Jar of Flies before using... compost. But obviously, we got ourselves a one run here. We're just chit chatting, ending a very enjoyable run, an enjoyable conversation, and it just strikes up a new conversation. How do we get the like streak to improve? What can I do better to make the thumbnails, you know, more appealing without being, you know, clickbaity? And I rarely, if any, that might be the first time I've ever mentioned another YouTuber since being a YouTuber in sort of a negative way. That was so annoying. I really liked Ants Canada too. It's just, and like, I tolerated the whole like AC fam thing, and the dude who runs it he seems like a cool guy. I just, After getting clickbaited really, really hard into a cliffhanger, it's like, all right, you know, now we're approaching one of those videos you see on the recommended tab. It's like, you know, the 10 most deadliest plants. Don't touch this. And they show a picture of a plant that isn't even in the video. It was that level of like intellectual insulting that I'm like, all right, well, I'm not going to stand for that. Anyway, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, click the like button. If you didn't, click the dislike button. Either way, it helps out and supports my channel. Truthfully, let's get that like streak back up to where it was. And as a reminder, for the 21-day like streak, I'll be checking out, I think it's called the Revelations mod, something like that. It's not related to Antibirth, but it's something that changes the game a whole lot, apparently. So, let's do it. Thank you for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. And as always, I'll see you all next time. Until then, so long. Mosh Pit fam. Ugh, I need to go wash myself.